Hi, welcome back to another episode of Real-World Serverless. Today, we are joined by Jack Kleeman from Restate, probably one of the most exciting, I guess, workflow orchestration services out there right now. Hey, man, good to see you.
Hey, how's it going? Good to see you as well.
Yeah, for context, so this is actually our second time recording this. The first time I actually got lost by a riverside. So, Jack, welcome back to the show. And can you maybe give us a quick summary of what's Restate? I'm sure so many people would have heard about it. Certainly, it was widely talked about at the AWS Heroes Summit in Seattle in July. We were talking to the Step Functions team, and quite a few people were talking about, have you seen what the Restate team is doing? Because mm-hmm. you guys are making a stir in that particular space.
That's good to know.
So yeah, tell us about yourself and what's Restate?
Yeah, sure. So Restate is a new way to build like reliable distributed systems, whether you're doing them serverless or just a normal like long-lived infrastructure, doesn't really make a difference. But the idea is that we're like helping you communicate between systems better. We're helping you keep track of state better. The reason that the Step Function team, maybe we're talking about it at AWS Heroes, is that we fill a similar niche in the market, which is this need for like durable orchestration. And what I mean by that is collecting results from different disparate systems and coordinating them into one place, writing them down, and then knowing when it's safe to continue. And this usually, like outside of a system like Step Functions, might require like a lot of interactions with databases and also queues and like trying to make everything reliable, you know, so that if a process crashes or something like that, it has a throw, we don't lose all of our sort of state that we've accumulated. And the goal of Restate is to make this a lot easier, and in particular to do this by writing code. So instead of writing ASL and like workflow definitions, you can kind of write normal sequential code that does things one step after another, ideally in any language, and ideally being able to still run on Lambda and other serverless platforms. So yeah, that's what we're doing. And in terms of my role, I've been at Restate for about 2 years, and I work on a range of infrastructure things. So I built our cloud platform, which obviously is what serverless fans want to use. And I also work on customer things and the Go SDK and lots of other bits and bobs.
Right. Yeah. So with like you said, the Restate manages the state. Well, Step Functions also manage the state of your workflow, which is basically like almost like a pointer or cursor of where your execution flow is. And so that if there's any problems, even though your code might fail, you can rely on Step Functions or Restate to keep track of where you are in the execution, and then restart or retry or exactly. Move on to the failure state and so on. So in that case, for me, being a serverless fan, and for people mm-hmm. that are listening to this podcast, we're probably most interested in the hosted version.
Yeah.
So Restate Cloud.
Sense. Yeah.
Because obviously, if we have to run the service ourselves, then there's another whole other set of responsibility that we're trying mm-hmm. to get away from. But in that case, so where do you put your state? Does the Restate come with some database? Is there some mechanism to make sure that the state, if you're running Restate yourself, mm-hmm. what happens if the Restate machine died? Do I lose the state of my execution and so on?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great question. So I guess Restate takes maybe the local state concepts from Step Functions and sort of puts it on steroids, because Restate is essentially a fully featured database. We don't rely on any external systems. We're not using Postgres or anything like that under the hood. We are the stateful system, very soon to be like a distributed stateful system as well. And we persist not just the state of your workflow, but actually you could also have long-lived state that persists between workflows. So you can have a sense of a workflow being keyed, and under that key, let's say a user ID, you can actually record information that otherwise you've turned to Dynamo. Now, of course, you can still use Dynamo, but the interesting thing about Restate is that we can give you unique access to that state, like while your workflow is running, and it makes it quite easy to solve certain types of coordination problems. So you might reach for it where you might have used like a managed Redis product as well, and areas like that. Restate relies on local disk, when Restate crashes or something like that, the data remains and Restate can restart and then continue like nothing happened. And I can show you that if that's helpful. This is the idea really, is that we are this kind of central durable store, and then you can rely on our stateful properties to build other systems that are much more stateless. So your lambdas maybe don't need to be reaching out as much to external systems. Maybe they would for like the business state, but maybe much less for the coordination state. A little bit like you would use the sort of context or the state that you build up in a step functions workflow, but with types and some other goodies.
Okay, yeah, it might be good to just see a maybe an example of it, because when you
Sure.
talk about the durable execution, it feels quite vague, unless you know what durable executions kind of mean.
It's true. Yeah, it's true. And it's a little bit different from step functions. So let's walk through. Maybe let's just start with a couple of examples from the website. Let me just share my screen quickly.
Sure. So for folks who are listening to the podcast on Spotify or some platforms like that, you can also go to YouTube. The link will be in the description below to see the full demo. So this might be quite useful as we are going through some code examples a bit
Yeah,
later.
definitely.
But we try to describe what we are doing as well. Okay,
Absolutely.
so I can see the website.
Great. So let's just start with the first example.
Can you
If this is
zoom
big
in a little
enough.
bit more? A little bit more, yeah. Okay, now it's
Okay,
better.
great. Oh, hold on. Things are moving around. Maybe this is not going to work that zoomed in. Is this going to work? No. Okay, cool. Let's just try the code example instead. We're moving around too quickly. Right, so I'm going to go through an example that's actually based on an AWS blog post, which might be familiar to some of your users, which is the
Sure.
holiday
Can
booking
you also
example.
make it zoomed in a little bit more? Because on my screen, it looks quite small right now.
Okay, how's this?
Yeah, that's better.
Okay, great. So the idea behind this holiday booking service is that you are coordinating like between a set of systems where for each one, you need to make sure that you don't leave it in like a bad intermediate state if there's some kind of failure. So we've all dealt with these kind of problems as programmers, right? Like you have sort of three fallible systems, and then any one of them can fail. And yeah, we have this situation in this case where we've sort of reserved flights, and then later we want to confirm them. But if there's some kind of failure later on, like let's say the payment fails, then we need to make sure that we unreserve the flight. So we need to keep track of like steps to undo it. And this you can imagine how this would be modeled in a step function situation. In fact, I can find the step function saga example. And they have a diagram of how it looks for them. So this is the sort of workflow diagram. And in step functions land, each one of these little itty bitty tasks is its own Lambda, right? And it has its own input and output state. And then they can also save like global values in the sort of global state as they do that. And in this case, they're also interacting. So their sort of state for in between workflows is this global dynamo tables because they don't have this concept that Restate has of like saving state more durably, like past the workflow finishing. But for the within the workflow, they have the workflow state, and then they have lots of little lambdas, and then the diagram shows how the lambdas sort of move between each other. So the idea
Yeah,
with
so
these, go, sorry, go.
I think in this particular example, they are the DB tables are not for the state of the workflow, but just
Exactly.
for the business data, business
Exactly,
state,
yeah.
like the payments and things like that. And so I
Exactly.
think the idea, at least the way I understand it, is that the, when you your the, you're actually booking flight, the booking car rental and whatever, those are state machine executions that can call Lambda function, and then you're gonna have a try catch around each one of those states. And then the interesting thing here is that when you roll back, you don't just want to roll back the state that failed, but also roll back the previous states that
Exactly.
whatever action they've done. So you have to sort of undo a payment, undo a flight booking, and undo a car rental booking, and then basically play back the rollback actions and everything that you've done up to now.
Exactly. And this is why people reach for workflow engines or durable execution more generally, is that if you just write this in code, the code can also just exit at any point. I mean, it just inherently, things can fail. And then you're guaranteed to have some situations where people are stuck somewhere in this chain. And then, that means that the state in the global table, the state that actually keeps track of which flights are reserved and so on, this is now incorrect. And you end up with like seats on your flight that can never be booked. And I think like this is a pretty common problem in lots of kind of companies. So the alternative to durable execution, I guess, would be to sort of scan your Dynamo tables periodically and look for tables that are, sorry, rows that are in this state, and then sort of roll them back. And that's absolutely something you can do. But the idea behind durable execution is to sort of prevent you from ever getting into this situation. And the way it does that is by essentially keeping track for each workflow execution. Where did we get to when there was a failure? And then you could sort of figure out from there, all right, then we know that we need to continue down this workflow until we get to the end. And the promise of durable execution is that this won't be considered done until the workflow actually says, I'm done.
I've seen so many people actually do the other way that you mentioned, that basically mm-hmm. have their own kind of a stage tracking, and then they have a cron job to find states or executions that didn't workflow that didn't finish. Yep. But then that means your rollback and your actual workflow is just kind of two separate things that is
exactly.
quite hard to visualize on the individual to user transaction basis of what actually happened. When did we try the thing? When did it fail? When did it got retried? All kind of separate parts. With workflows, it's nice to be able to see all of them in one, basically one page, one visualization.
Exactly, yeah. So this primitive of like functions that run to the end or workflows that run to an end, it makes it really easy to build reliable systems. So I think that's why people are so passionate
right.
about it. That's why people love step functions. So we are trying to replicate that same primitive, but with it looking a lot more like a normal handler, a normal code.
Right. And this is just a normal TypeScript code that you write to the
yep.
Lambda's context,
yep.
Or as in like, the invocation event and context, or is this something you're writing to a specific, documentation, format for
Restate?
Yeah,
it is a particular format. There's a Restate SDK, and the Restate SDK you write in terms of services and handlers on those services. So in this case, reserve here is a handler on the trip service. We define the trip service down here.
Okay.
It only has one handler. But if I click through, for
okay.
example, to the cars service, you'll see that there's a few handlers, reserve, confirm, cancel. But they don't look much different to something like TRPC or one of these frameworks, maybe also gRPC.
Okay.
And they do mostly normal things that normal code would do. And the Lambda bit really only happens at the top layer. So code in Restate looks the same, kind of irrelevant to where it runs. So this code, as I'm showing now, it can run in Lambda. You can see here, I'm exporting a handler for it to run in Lambda. But actually also for
okay.
local development, I've set up an app.ts that also runs all the same services, but on a local node service. And that allows me to run the services locally and have them be auto reloading and stuff like that. But it's running exactly the same code with exactly the same API. And this is kind of a nice property of just the RPC framework that we've built. But fundamentally,
so
in the end...
Can we look at the binding to the Lambda? Where did you do that?
Yeah, I did it down here in the case of the cars service.
Okay.
So I've defined a service. And there's
service,
also a type
okay.
for the service, which allows other services to call it. And then I just export the handler. And we use this thing called restate.endpoint. We bind it. And I do dot .handler. And that creates a Lambda endpoint handler, essentially.
Okay.
And we
right.
have
so
these, this is just like a
where you have the,
plugin,
okay.
right? We have them also for Cloudflare workers,
okay.
for Dino Run, for Bun, but basically all the serverless platforms that you might want to use, we have some kind of approach for them. Most of them just go through HTTP because most serverless platforms do just use HTTP, and Lambda is, the special one that doesn't. And so we've had to
right.
always have some special care for that. And Restate is able to invoke your Lambdas directly. It doesn't need to invoke them through an API gateway or anything like that. You register where your Lambda is deployed to Restate, you give it permissions to call it, and then we will invoke it as necessary to sort of progress your function.
So in this case, does your function, does a function equal a workflow, or is this the workflow will be something separate, and then
that's a good question.
Calls
so,
the individual functions you've got here.
Yeah, so I mean, in a sense, we have workflow style properties, but for normal services and for normal handlers. So
right.
you don't need to think about things necessarily. You can, if you choose to, as workflows and activities in quite the same way as step functions or as something like temporal. Instead, you just need to think about code. And splitting it up into services that make sense to you logically. And then
okay.
in this case, there is the trips handler. And this is where most of the orchestration is happening, because the other handlers are all doing kind of more simple things. They really just wrap Dynamo, to do the reservation, to do the cancellation. But the coordination
right.
steps are happening in the trips handler.
Ah,
so this
okay.
is the handler that you would typically call your workflow in step functions land. But actually, this handler has durable execution properties, and so do all the other handlers. We don't make this like separation. We think durable execution properties can be useful in all sorts of different code. And you can
Right.
deploy all
So
of these
this.
files to separate lambdas or to the same lambda. It doesn't really make a difference. We just figure out what services are running there and we can call them.
Okay. So the idea is that you've got this object that basically just runs code, and your code can implement the workflow. And because you have the providing this durable execution in terms of storage while storing the state of the workflow and so on, so you don't have to make the workflow a separate thing that's outside of your code. It just be your code, you know, almost like if someone takes your TypeScript code and converts that to step functions, executions, something like that.
It is a lot like that, yeah. So I guess the way to reason about it is wherever we use the context object, it kind of means that we're informing Restate that we're doing some kind of durable step. And a durable step means that we are writing down what you're doing and it goes to Restate and it gets stored, and your code won't continue until it knows it's been stored. And what that means in practice is that if you fail at some point, Restate can reinvoke the Lambda and give it the journal entries that it knows about. And then when you make another operation that would be durably stored, it will check to see, oh, did we already do this? And if it did, it will fill in the result and then it will continue. So that means that on retry, it will sort of zip through this
Right.
function to the point where it failed and it won't do any of these durable steps again. So in this handler, which is the sort of coordination handler, all of the durable steps are just calling other services, which in Restate is not just like
Okay.
HTTP, but is actually like writing down the request body. And then the other service gets it, and then you write down the response body, and it's sent durably. And that's a little bit similar to if you put everything through SQS. So if you were doing like an inbox outbox pattern where the requests go over SQS and the responses go over SQS, you would get similar properties to what we're offering. Except you don't have to worry here about like idempotency and like duplicate events because Restate won't make this request twice. Like on the retry, it won't make it again. It will just fill in whatever result it got last time. And that's really the magic that allows us to run the Lambda over and over again upon failures and on so on until it gets to the completion without doing these things all repeatedly.
Okay.
And that's the
Okay. All
magic.
right. So I guess conceptually that means when you say a durable step, it's basically a checkpoint in your code that you're able
Exactly.
to go back to and replay. So essentially, you have this separation of checkpoints. I guess that's maybe when you've made some state changes, and then you've got your business logic, which is all, you know, CPU work that's happening that you can safely replay and redo. Where you want the checkpoints when you're writing to, you know, some other external data store or updating the data, the state within that you are sharing between the different steps of your workflow and things like that, so that when you replay, basically it goes, you know, it starts from the previous known, I guess, checkpoint.
Exactly, yeah, exactly. So the way to think
Right.
about it in terms of the step functions example is that these sort of green things become just different sections of the code that are being durably stored. So each one of these is now, imagine that the Lambda execution, you just save the result and you move on. But you can actually combine them all into one handler. All of these little snippets of code can become one handler, but we're just storing in between each one. And, fundamentally, the
Right.
properties are the same of these two things. It's just that it's a lot easier to reason about. In the Restate land, because instead of them being split across different handlers, each with their own request and response, you can kind of use local variables and just normal control flow. So you can use try catch, and you can just, have a list of functions that are your
Right.
undo steps and just iterate over them. All of these sorts of things, it makes it a little bit easier to write the code,
Okay.
but has the same properties.
When failure is not an option for you should check out our sponsor this week, Momento. Momento helps you deliver fast, production-ready user experiences at more than 10 million requests per second. You don't have to worry about Redis timeout, WebSockets, hotkeys, and capacity management. It's built for massive, unpredictable scale, and Momento offers turnkey cache, PubSub, and storage solutions. It complements DynamoDB and is now featured on Amazon EventBridge as an API destination. So learn more at gomemento.co/theburningmonk. Okay, back to the episode. Okay, so I guess there are two things here. The first one I guess I want to call out is just the fact that you mentioned that calling the same Lambda function over and over. And I think that's something that people probably just don't understand right away, because what's actually happening here is that your workflow is inside a Lambda function, captured inside a Lambda function. And so in this case, when you say, okay, that one of the executions failed, maybe like a Lambda timeout or something like that, and then Restate is then going to reinvocate the same Lambda function again, and it's going to start from the previous checkpoint and start from there. And so in that case, it's the same Lambda function. It's not like you've got multiple Lambda functions, and Restate is managing, I guess, what event, and this is sent to Lambda function, and then it's the execution engine, I imagine, is doing some work to then make sure that you start from the bit of code that you finished at the last time, or at least when the last checkpoint.
Exactly.
Is
Yeah,
that
that's
correct?
exactly right. So instead of splitting things
Okay.
up into six lambdas with the request and response structs for each one, instead we can have six sections of one lambda, and we just
Right.
invoke it repeatedly to progress further each time. So, every
Okay.
invocation to the lambda gets to some point and then stops. And it might stop because of a failure. It might also stop because it needs to save something to Restate. You know, it needs to send some information back to Restate. So Restate will then write that down and reinvoke it. So this is the essential mechanism of the
Okay,
communication.
gotcha. Okay, all right. So this is,
Exactly.
so from that perspective, it's still very similar to how I guess the execution behavior is very similar to what step function would do. Basically, if you
Exactly.
have six Lambda invocations, except you don't have to break it up into six actual Lambda functions. It's one
Yeah.
function, one block of code, and the Restate is just managing the, when to get the return, when to call it again.
Exactly.
Okay,
And you don't have to serialize
I think
everything. I
that's
think
clear.
that's the other thing, right? And like in step functions, you need to have these explicit request and response bodies. But it is actually possible
Right.
to build up things in memory over the course of the function. You don't have to save them, like
Right.
you don't have to write them down necessarily. And then on the replay, they'll just be built up in memory again. And this can actually be quite convenient. Like you don't have to think about everything in terms of like serializable objects, but some objects can just be here in memory, and we can just pass them directly to the functions further down the function, and it will work.
Okay.
But that's a big difference.
Okay, yeah. And I guess the second question I had there as you were going through the code is that if the checkpoints are basically when you're calling that the object or
The
object
context.
context
Yeah,
or
exactly. Yeah.
context, yes. So is that still a case where you can, because ultimately I want my checkpoints to be when I just made the state change in, say, writing something in DynamoDB. Because everything else is just compute, it's just CPU work, I can redo that. Where I've got some state written somewhere else, that's when I need to worry about, okay, if I replay, do I need to worry about item potency? Am I going to charge someone twice? So in that case, is there still a chance of failure for, say, you just make a call to strike to credit someone, well, to charge someone's credit card, you call a contact to make a checkpoint right after the checkpoint fails. Is that a possibility for that? So that
Absolutely, yeah. I mean,
when,
we're not wizards.
okay.
You can't, for example, I mean, if strike returns a 500, you do not know in general whether that payment has happened or not. So this is an unsolvable problem without idempotency keys, and that's why Stripe, is so good with idempotency keys, right?
Yes, they've got like skills and things like that. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So this is just we can't do any magic there. Obviously the process can crash. But let me show you a place where we use the actual context to run. So this is the trick that you use to save an arbitrary result, and this is essentially saying I want
Okay.
this thing to happen once. And this will mean that on replay, i.e. if we've got past this point to a later point, but then there was a failure and then we replay, this won't happen again. But if I die here, process.exit or something, this cannot be saved. And alternatively, if SNS
Right.
returns a 500, we don't know whether it's happened. So inside these context.run blocks, you should ideally be doing things that are idempotent if it's critical, something like a payment. Now, something like an SNS notification, given that we would consider this to be very rare, probably doesn't matter so much. But if, for example, you're writing to a database, it makes sense to do, insert if not exists or something along those lines to make sure that you have idempotent writes. And of course, Dynamo supports idempotency keys and probably SNS does as well. And if you need to generate a key, that's actually really easy. So you could do context.run.uuid, which creates that's like a very fast pathway to create a random thing. And this will not change across like the lifetime of the invocation. It won't change on replay, for example. You can also do context.run and generate like a timestamp, or context.run and generate like any kind of random number, and that will then be saved. And then you can use that key as your idempotency key. So it's really easy to interact with external systems if they support some kind of idempotency. If they don't support some kind of idempotency and you're talking to them over the network, it is impossible in general to avoid the possibility, you know, mm-hmm. the small possibility of some duplicate writes. Right. There is a caveat here. The requests that stay within Restate, they do have an exactly once guarantee. We actually won't like invoke that other service more than once if you've only asked to do it once. But of course, at some point, if you're doing useful work, you must be interacting with an external system eventually, right? And at that point, yes, indeed, you need to be idempotent on the outbound. And this is also true in reverse. So for things that call into Restate, you know, Restate is essentially an API gateway for all of your services. You can just invoke them over the network of HTTP. And you need to consider about idempotency there as well. You know, it's possible that your TCP connection could just fail, and then you may not know whether your request actually was processed or not. So Restate supports natively idempotency keys. So every request, you can provide a key. And then if you provide the same key again within 24 hours, you'll get the same result and it won't be re-invoked. So this makes it really easy to have like retries, for example, from the front end. Let's say someone clicks the payment button. You want to the front end to retry maybe three or four times. Maybe their Wi-Fi just restarted. You want to provide the same idempotency key to make sure that it doesn't, the payment doesn't happen twice. And where I've worked in the past, I've done this much deeper in the stack. You know, just before making a payment, we check that idempotency and then we, fail the whole thing. But actually with Restate, you don't even need to do that. You can do this like at the edge, straight up, the invocation just won't be processed a second time, which makes things kind of easy. But yes, absolutely, you do still need to think about idempotency. But you don't need to think about idempotency of the whole handler, right? You don't have to think about, okay, what if I fail here and then the whole thing happens again? And that's what normally idempotency is like when you have retries, is you're like, okay, the whole thing is going to happen again from the start. In Restate, only the last thing that's just happened is the thing that can happen again. So in this case, it's like these blocks.
Okay. And I guess before we move on, I also want to just spell it out to folks who are listening, because maybe not everyone is familiar with different ways to idempotency, because what you did describe last bit when you say Restate supports idempotency keys, basically this is the caller creates their own, creates like unique GUID, whatever, unique ID for the transaction, and then when they call Restate to do a thing, they pass that their key into Restate. And Restate make sure that when they see the same key again, if, even if the first time they didn't get your response, they call Restate. Restate say, 200, but it got lost somewhere in the network. Restate knows, okay, I've seen this key before. I'm not going to do this thing again. I'm just going to give you back the result from the last time.
Absolutely. Yeah. So these bridging points between Restate and external systems, whether on the inbound or on the outbound, these are still places that you need to think carefully about idempotency and about duplicate writes. But what we tried to make it true is that within Restate, when calling other services, other handlers, you don't have to think about those things. And that can make it quite easy to build like reasonably complex systems where you only have to worry like at the start and the end, which is quite nice.
Right. Okay. I guess under the hood, how do you guys do it with, say, you know, TypeScript or Go? How do you capture this checkpoint and turn your code into multiple resumable executions?
Yeah, I think the way to think about it in your head is it's as if you are talking with a queue constantly. So if you imagine that this handler was instead a SQS consumer, so the inbound request comes as an event, and then basically every durable step is me completing that handler and emitting an event back to say, okay, this is my intermediary state. And then we just presume that the SQS then invokes another handler with the now both events, the start event and the second event, and so on and so on and so on. So it's like every single one of these durable steps is an event emission. And then what Restate is under the hood is a very performant queue that understands deeply your application, but fundamentally it is just taking these events and giving them back to your app. Now, in long-lived infrastructure or some serverless platforms like Cloud Run or Dino Deploy, we can actually do HTTP2 bidirectional streaming with your serverless function. And that means that we can actually exchange these events like in real time without the application having to complete. In Lambda, because Lambda is a bit quirky and doesn't have full bi-di streaming, We actually just use returns. So we just return back to Restate when we need to give it
Right.
information, and then it reinvokes. I really hope that at some point Lambda will have request and response streaming and that we won't need to do that anymore.
Right.
But that's how we do it for
Yeah,
now.
they do have a they do have response streaming.
They
It's just
do.
the request streaming.
Exactly. Yeah, they do. Yeah. So
Okay.
we need to be
I
able
guess in that
to
case,
give you more information while you're running. So you need to be able to send information back, and then we need to send you
right.
information. So it's definitely both directions we need.
Okay, so in that case, do you need to capture the local variable values as well as part of that return value?
So yeah, so there's no like memory reading wizardry sort of thing. It's the common misconception about Java execution. We just need to store everything that you do with the context. So if you're doing something out of the context,
Okay.
it just needs to be deterministic so that we rely on the if we give you the same input and the same context things, that all the other in-memory state is going to build up to be the same. And if you're doing something that's
Okay.
really slow and CPU bound, then you're probably going to want to wrap that in context.run. And the same goes if you want to
Okay.
interact with an external system or do something non-deterministic. These are all cases where you're basically just saying, do this thing and save the result. And by save the
Okay.
result, I mean send it back to restate and then continue with that result saved. And that's
Okay, right.
how you interact with almost
So
everything. And it's only really the
the
in restate
reason
things that
why
don't. Sorry, go ahead.
The reason why I ask is that if you are created the I made the I make a call to a durable, well, to one of the context objects, and then I've got some intermediate thing I want to reference a bit later. And because you're calling the Lambda function again, how can I make sure, because I've got some local state within my workflow that are not written to restate, it's just some in memory thing that I've done some calculations or what have you. How can I make sure that when you invoke the function again on another step, it's got the right value for the local variables?
Yeah, exactly. So if you haven't written it in a context to run, which of course a context to run, you can return values and then store them, right? So this is like
Right.
essentially how you do that. But if you don't want to do that, for
Right.
example, because this has some cost, right, to send the information back to restate and wait for it to be acknowledged. Anything that you just do in memory, as long as it's deterministic, then it should have the same value again, right? So
Because
you
you're going to just
just
run it again
exactly. This is
from
the trick, is
the
we
okay,
don't
gotcha.
jump to here. It's not like a go-to, but we actually do run every line. And
Right.
then the context makes sure that you don't do side effects again, but it does run the line of code. So for example, this input
Okay,
struct is going to be built
gotcha
again.
now.
And for example, here, you can see here I've done context.console.log, not console.log. If I did console.log, and maybe we could show this, it's going to write reserve trip every time it replays. But if I
Right,
use the
but because
context
you're
one,
using
then
your
restate
own,
hides that. Yeah.
right? Okay, gotcha. Okay, so I guess that actually makes a really important nuance here. That even if you want to call something like third-party APIs or DAMDB or anything like that, you don't want you have to you you want to do that with a wrapper of the context or run around it. Otherwise, when the function gets replayed again, it's going to do the same thing again. It's going to be the same call again. If it's a get, it might just be a problem in terms of load. But if it's a write, that means that you're now running the same state again, which because
Exactly.
Restate doesn't know that you did that last time. Okay, gotcha.
Exactly. And I
Okay,
think
so basically,
this is
any
the
IO you kind of want to,
exactly. It's IO.
any
That's
IO you want
exactly
to kind of
it. It's
put in the, okay,
the
gotcha.
activities. And
Right.
this is the best comparison to the lambdas in the step functions thing or activities in temporal. So whereas everything
Right.
else is, I guess, coordination, it's sort of like defining the flow chart, but using normal code control flow. These things inside the run, these are the lambdas, and they actually have similar properties to the step functions lambdas in that ideally you want them to be idempotent because they could, of course, fail. So then in step functions, you typically use like a retry, right? If something is
Right.
potentially fallible. So they ideally would be idempotent. And also, the response from the lambdas must be serialized, right? So, if I return a value from the context to run, because this needs to be stored in restate, it probably needs to be a serializable value. So it's very similar to the lambdas, but the nice thing is that there's a lot you can do without, there's a lot of other stuff you could do in the function that, on the coordination side without just being inside the lambda, and there you have a lot more flexibility. But yeah, whenever you do IO, you definitely need to use the context.run.
Okay, gotcha. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Sorry. I should stop you when you were in the middle of
Oh no, it's fine. I mean, maybe we
to the
can
next bit
progress on
of demo.
to maybe we can run this locally and we can show the demo. But I just
Yeah,
wanted
sure.
to
Let's
show
do
one
that.
other magical thing about this in the case of lambdas, and which is that it makes them suspendable. And what I mean by that is because we're returning whenever we do, something important that we need to save results, and then we restart later. That's not just an implementation detail. That's something you can rely on. So let's say that I want to wait for an hour. I can do context.sleep 300,000, right, which is an hour. And if I do a wait on that, what the Lambda will do is the moment that it sees this, it will just stop. It will stop running. And then an hour later, Restate's going to reinvoke it. And this is really cool because you can
Gotcha.
create Lambdas that span time, even though they're using in-memory variables and they have some sense of what they've already done, they still can span huge amounts of time without it costing you anything. So this is a really nice property. But anyway, on
Right.
with the
Yeah,
example.
that's actually one of the things people use their functions for.
Exactly.
It's quite funny that when the I forgot who it was at reInvent was talking about how they build this really robust execution platform, and all people do was make it wait and sleep.
Yeah, because I mean, this is one of the hardest things to do without durable execution is
Yeah,
span time. Exactly, yeah.
because
Okay.
somebody have to keep track of that and the wait,
Someone
and
has
no
to,
one
yeah,
wants
someone
to.
has to be running. Someone has to be running, and they have
Yes.
to keep track of what you've already done and know where to reinvoke you
Yeah.
and so on. And this is a hard problem. So yeah, it's actually one of the coolest things, especially in the context of serverless, is this. Okay, so I'm
Okay,
going to
all
show a
right.
little bit of how this works locally. So I show the local dev experience, and then I'm also going to show the sort of CDK and the Lambda dev experience as well, and show that they're actually, you're very flexible between the two of them.
Okay.
So locally, I'm just gonna. So these services, they all use Dynamo, just like in the example. So I've already deployed the Dynamo table, and I'm just gonna make sure that that's in my environment. And then I'm going to run the service. And app dev is just using TSX to run locally this file, which is not like a file that I
Okay.
deploy. It's just the one that I use to have like a local host dev server. So it just binds all the
Okay.
services into one dev server.
Okay.
And also I need the Restate server. I could also be using the Restate Cloud environment. I'm going to show that a little bit later on, but the time being, I just want to show like it's really easy to start a Restate server locally. It's just one command. It runs like on your Mac, and this is not like a fake dev server. This is like the actual thing. It work like has all the functionality, and I'm also going to use the CLI. So the way Restate works is it pushes requests right to services. So this is how Lambda. This is how it's able to support Lambda. It's not that services pull from a Restate server. So these services don't need to know where Restate is or anything like that. Restate does need to know where it is. So when I'm using it locally, I'm going to do this restate dep register. Let's make this full screen. And what it will do is it will
Depth
go and
register.
see what's running at
Okay.
that address that I gave it. And I can also give it a Lambda ARN. Either way, it'll work the same way. It will do like a special call that says, what do you run? And in this case, it says, okay, I run cars, flights, trips, payments. There's a few handlers on each one.
Okay.
There's a little bit of information about the content types expected and stuff like that.
So those are the handlers that we registered in those objects. And so in the when
Exactly.
you create those restate objects, you say what handlers you have. So that's what these
Exactly.
are, right? The
Yeah,
ones you
that's exactly
registered. Okay.
right. Restate has a little bit of knowledge about what your handlers are running. And the reason that that's useful to Restate is that, like I said before, it's a little bit of an API gateway. So it now has a sense of these are the services that it has. It knows how to call them. And that means that.
What's the difference between a virtual object and the service if they both just expose a bunch of handlers?
The main difference is the virtual objects have a key and they must be invoked with a key. And what that gives them is the
Okay.
ability to write down information that persists under that key longer than the lifetime of the handler or of the workflow, quote unquote. And that means that
Okay.
actually in this example, I haven't done it, but we could do it. We could not use Dynamo at all and store the information against the key using something like this, context.set.
Okay,
Reservation
so
under that key. But I haven't done that in this example, but that's essentially what virtual objects like to do.
okay, right. Okay, and then that value is going to be associated with the key across
Yeah,
all
associated forever.
executions.
Yeah, exactly. It's going to be associated forever, and further
Okay.
invocations to that key just like a primary key in Dynamo, they'll have the same state. And this allows you to sort of build more complex features where otherwise you would need to pull in Dynamo. And the nice thing is that you don't have to think about things like adipotency or like coordinating with Dynamo more generally. You know, you don't have to think about, oh, what if this runs twice or things like that, because Restate is storing the state in the same place fundamentally as your invocation state or your handler state. So that's the trick. And indeed, these emojis mean that these are virtual objects. But I haven't actually used the virtual object functionality much here.
We don't actually need to have all of those objects. We don't need to have them as a virtual object. They can all be services in this case.
In this case, yes. The only exception to that is that because virtual objects run on the key, they have single writer over that key by default. So when they're running, they're the only thing running on that key. So generally, if I'm writing something that interacts with an external stateful system, and there's like a natural keying to it, I would probably still put it in a virtual object because it kind of gives me a nice sort of concurrency control property. You know, Dynamo isn't really going to allow concurrent writes to a single primary key anyway. So we may as well, you know, use Restate to enforce that. And the nice thing there is that I also can get a sense of like hot keys. You know, if I have invocations queuing up on that key, then, you know, maybe I can get a sense that something is wrong. And otherwise, that might be a little bit hard to detect. So that's still a little bit of a nice to have. Restate is inherently sharded on these keys. And whereas a service, there's sort of a random key and it doesn't really, there's no like locking. In a virtual object, you have this like logical or semantic key that actually means something, and therefore being sequential might be a nice thing. In this case,
so a couple of questions, and also maybe just a restate what you just said. So virtual objects are essentially they've got their own key, they've got a key, and that kind of makes them a singleton, so that you can guarantee that only one instance of it is going to be running at any moment in time. And so that's also, I guess, my question there is then the. Does it have to wait for the whole execution to finish before you run to the next one? Or when you are calling something like context and you write something to Restate and returns, and can it pick up the next execution in the queue?
Yeah, it's a good question. By default, we have the whole handler. And the reason for that is that you might be doing many different coordination tasks in the handler that all need to have a lock over that state. There is such a thing as what's called a shared handler. I don't have an example of it here, but a shared handler has a read-only access to the state, and the shared handler can run concurrently. So this is really nice for having workflows that have like a sort of main synchronous task and then sort of status endpoints or like other handlers that do smaller things. That's really helpful as well. The idea is that we don't want to enforce too much, but we want it to just be like the simplest and easiest to reason about locking mechanism that we can think of, which is basically just this idea of you either have the full lock or you have no lock.
Gotcha.
Cool. But you can implement all kinds of different things on top of this. I mean, this is just the simplest possible primitive that we can offer. Anyway, so we've discovered these services now. So I should just be able to curl them. So I'm going to be curling the trips service. Let's maybe go and visualize that. And because this is running locally, I'm able to like run a debugger and like all that normal stuff that you would do. Hang on. I need to make sure that I have not got anything weird running. Okay, that's more like it. Okay. Restate server. Curl localized ADA. No. Demo gods. Requested resource.
Requested
not found.
Resource not found. I think it's like it is probably dump DB table or something.
Yes, that could be it. Let's try restarting this. Maybe I haven't correctly got the Dynamo tables or something like that. That looks right there. So you see the Restate, even though I had to restart it, it still has these invocations that it's trying to complete. And if I start it up again, it's going to try and start running them again. Requested resource not found. It's very strange.
Are you in the same, the right region?
Oh, yeah, maybe not. Oh, yeah, okay, yeah. That's exactly it. This is right, isn't it? Address region equals US East 2.
East 2, okay.
There we go.
That looks better.
So this is the funny thing, right? It's like the curl that I did locally, it will just keep trying until it works. And now it does work. Okay. So that was just one reserve call, and now it works. So by default, invocations in Restate are, you know, can be very long-lived. Obviously, you can still have a timeout, but we will like keep trying until that thing works, even if the underlying endpoint isn't running, even if the underlying endpoint is crashing, you know, we will keep trying and try and get a result for you. So let's also just show you a little bit of this failure compensation. So this is a, there's like this run type parameter, and if there's a run type parameter, then we decide to fail by basically throwing immediately before like sending the notification. So this would be the notification step, like saying, you know, SNS, it's worked. We fail before that point. And then you see there's the catch, and the catch will then undo the steps. So let's see what happens if I do that. Yeah, so it says failed to send notification, successfully applied three compensations. If we look, have a look over here at the, no, not those ones, at the logs, you see that, you know, it did all the steps that are required. So it refunded the payment, deleted the car rental reservation, all of these Dynamo operations, and it deleted the flight reservation. So it undid everything. But if I instead fail, you know, earlier on, so if I decide, for example, to fail the car reservation, which is called this, fail car rental reservation, then it will just run the compensations required to get to, oh, I must have the wrong parameter or something like that. Oh, right, yeah, okay. Anyway, it doesn't really matter. But the point is it can fail at any point, and it will continue from that point. And then it will get to, it will catch the error, and then it will just undo all the steps that were necessary at that point onwards. So this is like the basics of the property
and
that we're offering.
You mentioned that you can also do the use breakpoints as you were running this locally.
Yep.
Can you just put breakpoint somewhere so we can just see
this is my mistake for using Zed, because Zed doesn't have a built-in debugger yet. Okay. Even though it's an amazing editor, but I can just do the node like inspect things. So let's just do that. There we go. Let's just figure this out. NPM run build. Nope. No, not TSC. Very annoying. Mm-hmm. Oh, run bundle.
And I guess while you do this, another question is that in terms of language support, obviously you support TypeScript. What other languages that do you support?
Go, Java, Kotlin, Rust, and Python. So hopefully that will cover most bases.
JavaScript as well, because it's TypeScript.
Yeah, raw JavaScript as well. Okay. Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
Right. So going over to here, you can see that I have a debugger. You can see the sources. Hopefully you can see all of this.
Can you make that bigger?
Perhaps let's do that. Maybe make this
and
full screen.
Zoom in a bit as well.
Okay.
Maybe one more. Okay, that's better. All right.
And then we'll do a debugger here. And then the debugger is attached. This is good. So what's going to happen? It's going to get stuck.
Okay.
It's going to get stuck at this point.
Right.
And oh, I've also got one here. If I just continue that. Now it's going to get here. And it gets stuck at these points. And then, oh my goodness. Oh, I also need the region. I also need the region for this one, right? But yeah, the debugger works normally. It's just a completely normal local request, essentially. So let's get back up here, maybe. I never know how to actually set a debugger. Remove breakpoint. Oh, that's the, okay, I need to open it up again. There we go. Okay, I've got breakpoints all over the place now. So you see it triggers, and then you can see variables as
Right.
normal. So this is the idea. So this is like maybe
Okay.
a slightly easier local dev experience than using Lambda, without you having to like maintain completely two different entry points where they have like really different code. I mean, local stack also works pretty well, I found, but yeah, I've had a bit of struggle with it. And then with CDK, you can do like the hot deploy and just run in production. But yeah, it's not as easy as I would like. So generally, what we're doing, for example, in Restate Cloud, which is all built on top of Restate, we have exactly this pattern where we have local dev servers that just run on Node and use like normal Node developer tools, and then you have Lambda entry points as well, and then you bundle those up.
Okay.
Cool.
And I guess in that case, do you also have something similar to step functions visualization so they can see where the workflow, for a particular execution went?
Yeah, so this is coming. We aren't ready yet, but we do have
Okay.
some early screenshots. Let me show these. So we're working on these. So we have OTel tracing already, but we're working on some visualizations that go a bit beyond that, as well as like service display, like showing you what services you have registered and like what invocations are running, and these kinds of things are all coming. The other thing that we have as of very recently is this Xstate integration. So if any of the users have tried using Xstate on the front end, so to build state machines,
Okay.
we now have a way to like literally run those state machines as is, but as Restate services and like against Restate Cloud, for example. So you can essentially move these
Okay.
state machines to the server side. And the nice thing there is that Xstate has also like a nice way to design and visualize state machines as flowcharts. And then it will produce the code for you, and then this like sort of Restate Xstate interpreter turns that code directly into a Restate service. So there's a lot of different ways of interacting with it, but I think the thing I'm most excited about is this UI.
Okay, so that UI kind of looks more like the kind of X-ray UI which or something that shows the tracing as opposed to the step function UI which shows you like actually diagram, well, like
That's
a
absolutely right, but
graph.
I think there will be cases where we want to show the graph, and I think we will provide options for that as well. I mean, fundamentally, the information
Okay.
that we have is the same as the information the step functions has. Like we know, what line of code you're on. We know sort of what durable steps have happened and what their results were. So we can visualize that in a few different ways. For people writing more like service-oriented code, I think they often want traces. And then I think for people writing more like
Right.
workflow-oriented code, they often want more like graphs. So I think we'll show both.
Yeah.
It's most likely what we want to do.
Okay. Yeah, makes sense. And I guess the step functions is, in step functions case, the graphs are, well, makes more sense because it's no, they are just two kind of workflow. That's literally what they call their thing, right? Standard workflow versus express workflow. Whereas you got, whereas Restate is a little bit just okay. You got this durable execution, which you can do sequential stuff, or you can use it to build workflows as well.
That's exactly it.
And also, one more question about concurrency control, because how would you go about doing like parallel steps? For example, if I've got something I want to do in parallel in my code, how would that work in terms of the restate states?
Absolutely. So the easiest way to do that is putting the things you want to put in parallel into handlers. So for example, you might want to do, I mean, it doesn't really make sense in this example, but let's say I wanted to do confirm and cancel in parallel and see who wins. I can absolutely do that.
Right.
And then in the caller, let's go to trips, we have this thing called combinable promise. And this has like race and all and like all of these different helper functions,
Okay.
which is really nice. And the reason that you can't just use the normal ones is because they're not deterministic. So on replay, you can't be sure that the same thing won the race and things like that. But we could take care of that. So if you do combinable promise dot all or dot race across like a list of restate operations, so these are the promises returned from like for example restate services invocations. Sorry, I'm trying to remember my JavaScript syntax right now. So this is for example one. Then this will actually, you know, figure out which one won the race or which one lost the race and actually save that durably. And therefore, okay. It will be deterministic. And this is essentially how you do parallelism. So if you want to have like six things running concurrently, you can put them all into all or put them all into race, and also all settled to implement, and any, and all of these will like work reliably. And what does this mean in terms of the actual lambdas, right? So the lambda waiting will probably suspend immediately. So it will just stop. And then the underlying things will be called, and those will be separate lambda invocations. So you'll need the typical amount of lambda concurrency. If I want to do six things, it's going to do six concurrent things. It's going to make six right. lambda concurrency. And then let's say that I'm doing race. So in that case, the first one is will wake me up, right? Then the calling lambda is going to wake up when the first one completes. So it probably uses the same amount of concurrency. But yeah, it kind of works as okay. you would expect, but nothing needs to wait around on I.O. That's really the critical thing
and
when using lambda.
And I guess because you're calling lambda synchronously with the synchronous with the request response invocation. So when we do this, we do need to make sure that you have enough concurrency units in the region to allow. Okay, all right, that makes sense.
That's true. Okay. Yeah, definitely. But the coordination thing often doesn't run for very long. So really, you know, the lambdas are only running when they're doing quote unquote work. So for example, you know, when they're executing context.run, we obviously can't suspend you. But whenever they're just waiting on another handler using the Restate API, that will not keep the lambda running. And that's really important if you want to, you know, have long duration things. So if I did have this confidable promise race and this payment.process was sleeping for an hour or for a year or whatever, that wouldn't be a problem. I wouldn't need to like actually wait on that. And that's really helpful.
Right. Yeah.
Cool. So maybe let's move on to the CDK side of things, right?
Yes.
And show a little bit like Restate Cloud and Lambda in general. So currently I just have this return statement because I've only deployed the tables, but let's just walk through slowly what I've got in my CDK stack. So I've got some tables, and this is very similar to the Lambda example, the step functions example that they built, just did it very similarly to that. We have an SNS topic, and then I have some lambdas, and these just come from, they're just completely normal lambda deployments of these files that I showed before, right? The trips, the flights, right. the cars, and the payments
because
files.
Because at the end, you export the handlers so that this
exactly,
is what
yeah.
you're basically referencing.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they're totally normal lambda files with the Restate SDK bundled in, and I make sure that they can read the various Dynamo tables. And then we're going to go on to some sort of stuff that we've built. So we have our own CDK construct for deploying against Restate Cloud. So this Restate environment is sort of a general concept of where Restate might be running. And there's a few ways that can exist. There's the self-hosted one, for example, but we're not going to worry about that. But this is actually a construct to deploy Restate in your AWS. But we don't like doing that. We're serverless people. So this is the important thing, is that we make permissions for Restate Cloud, and we know where our Restate is running, and that we have a token for it, for us to be able to register services against it. And then we have this thing called deployer.deploy service, and it will use that information to register the version of the Lambda against that Restate service. So the main thing that it needs to know where the Restate Cloud environment is, it needs to know its ID, which I mean, and it needs to know a secret for the auth token. So let's go to Restate Cloud and let's get those things. So what is Restate Cloud? It is just our hosted Restate platform, and it runs Restate environments for you. I've already got an account here, but you can just log in with Google SSO or with GitHub, and you can get a free account and a free environment. Let's make an environment. Let's call it serverless. Okay, and it's creating. And most of the things here that you would expect. There's an integration with the CLI. We can create API keys. We can call it. So there's like authenticated way to call your services, which obviously is important. And there's a little bit of information about how to give it permission to, for example, call your lambdas. This the CDK is going to do for us, though, so we don't need to worry too much about that. But the general idea is that, as you would expect, Restate Cloud needs to be able to assume a role in your AWS account, and that role obviously needs to be able to invoke the Lambda. And we use the external ID to make that secure, to know that it's that your environment that's calling you. Cool. So let's just grab that environment ID. And we will go to back to Z, and I will make sure that I have the right commands. So I need to go over here, export and via okay. And then I also want to make sure that I can create an auth token in the correct region. And for that, I need to get one. So this is for the deployer in the CDK. I need to have admin operations, which means it needs to be able to register services essentially. Okay, that was pretty easy. Okay, and then let's just check that that worked. Oh, now I've just copied and pasted the key. Great. Okay, we have an error. So then I have, let's make this big. In my package.json, I have this CDK deploy, and it's gonna make us an environment. Or it's gonna deploy the lambdas, and it's gonna deploy the environments, the deploy
Right.
them to the environments. So you can see here it's bundled them all up, and it's gonna do CDK. What do we got? We've got all the Dynamo permissions that you would expect. And it's also going to create this service deployer, which is basically like a Lambda that backs the construct that I showed before. And that Lambda
Right.
is just going to register all of these versions. The cool thing about using CDK is it can automatically, when you make a new Lambda version, it will register that to the Restate. And Restate will make sure that new invocations go to the new version. And this gives you pretty similar properties to the way step functions handles versioning, where the workflow definition is the same. Well, it won't change for in progress workflows runs, but
Right,
for
okay.
new workflow runs, it will pick up the new versions, and that makes it a lot easier to build like backwards compatible workflows.
Yeah, I guess in that case, that's another thing that you have to keep in mind, just that if you've got things that are waiting for a long time, you have to keep those older versions around for at least the entire duration of those long-running executions.
That's exactly right, and that's why durations of invocations that run forever are probably a bit of an anti-pattern. I guess maybe similar in step functions because they just don't, you can't change them. And the way that you approach that in Restate is with state, really. That's one of the really cool things about the state that persists for longer than the invocation, because you can write things down, and then you can, instead of sleeping for a year, you can schedule an invocation in the year. So you can say, in a year, I'm pretty sure that this handler and this service will still exist. But I don't want my invocation to last all of that time. And this means
Is there an
that
option
it's much easier.
to use the latest alias instead of a version? Is if that's what I want to
Absolutely,
always just invoke the
you
latest
can.
version.
If you don't want to worry about
Okay.
this at all, and if you're not using the CDK, it's definitely a lot easier to just use the latest. You can absolutely just discover and deploy against the latest.
Okay.
But if you are using the CDK, then I find generally it's easiest to keep the old versions around. AWS doesn't seem to really charge for them. There is like a quota. And what we're working on right now also is for the deployer to automatically prune the old versions when they no longer have invocations running, which is very
Ah,
easy to
okay.
do.
I think
And that
that's probably
helps.
a better way to do that because
Yeah, definitely.
there's a limit, and also AWS is also starting to tighten the sort of, the things that they used to not charge you. So who knows? Maybe one day they will start
Yeah.
charging you, and you don't want to
Honestly, I
be
would
holding the
rather that
bag because
they
you've got like so
did.
much.
I would rather that they did charge me and that there wasn't a limit, because it's, even if you
Right.
have a 1 MB bundle, it's going to be a long time before your AWS bill is meaningfully affected by your old versions.
Right.
Anyway, okay,
Yeah.
so we're deployed now. And I also, the other thing I need to do is I just want to like get my CLI set up against my account and against my new environment. So maybe we'll use, where did we do the CLI before? Did we do it here? Yeah. Let's do Restate Cloud login. And it's going to open my browser. Let me just move the tab over to the right place. Don't know how to do that. Okay, here we go. Do-do-do. Let me log in with my Google. And it's going to show a nice shiny screen. We go back to Z. So now I'm logged in. I can do Restate Who Am I? And it shows me that I'm configured to talk to this environment.
Okay.
I think. Oh no! One more step. Restate env configure. Restate cloud env configure. and it's going to list what accounts I have. Okay, we have this new account called serverless, also this new environment called serverless, and it's going to configure me to talk to that. So now my ingress URL is talking to the environment, and it's got my environment ID and my account ID. And now if I do restate service list, it will show those services that we had before. If I do dep list, it will show that they're now actually talking to the Lambda. So this is not, by the way, let me just shut this down. This is not the restate that I have running locally. Let me be really clear about that. This is the restate that's okay. running in the cloud, and it's talking to Lambdas and USDs too.
Right.
So let's continue the dev experience from there, right? So most of the time, I don't want to have to worry about like the ingress URL and the bearer token if I'm running locally. So the way we approach that is we just do this thing called Restate Cloud Env Tunnel. And what does that do? Okay, it does a few useful things. It, first of all, exposes my local ports and sends them up to the server side. So I just get this unauthenticated local endpoint, 8080, exactly like if I was running it locally, but it's actually the cloud's like authenticated thing, and that works through a proxy. A little bit like using ngrok or something like that.
Right.
And then the other thing that it does, and I'll show this a little bit later, is it allows me to run services locally and expose them to cloud without having to like have my computer on the public internet or anything like that, which is helpful also. But we'll worry about that in a little bit. So in the meantime, we should have the service now. It's running in Lambda. There'll be a cold start the first couple of times maybe. But we have the service running fully. And it's nice. So not much different local dev experience versus any other experience
so
running with Lambda.
Let me just understand. So this is you calling a tunnel from basically invoking the local endpoint, but calling the remote instance.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So okay. I could be curling like this. So this is the ingress URL, and then I need to create like a invocation API key, and then save that locally. And this is kind of annoying dev experience. So what we do instead is you can use your like SSO creds to log in with the CLI locally, which you saw earlier. That was what this step. And then with my SSO creds, I can create this
You're
local proxy.
A two-way tunnel so that you
exactly,
able to
yeah.
invoke
yeah.
local endpoint that trigger the remote API and vice versa, have the remote runtime calling your local version of the functions.
That's exactly right, yeah. So
okay.
we'll do that later.
Gotcha.
And the goal here is that you can sort of switch between services that are running in Lambda, services that are running locally, and also switch between Restate running locally and Restate running in a cloud. All of these things are just like really easy to switch between without having to swap around tokens and environments and stuff like that. That's our goal. So
sounds good.
Let's actually show the next step of that. So we've shown that we have like, running the Lambda now. You know, it's not that exciting because it just looks exactly the same, but maybe I want to run one of them locally. So if I just run the trip service, if I go back here, address region, C2, npm, run trips, dev, something like that. Yeah. Oh, there we go. Now we have a debugger. Oh yeah, there's the dash dash inspect. Okay, this is good. So now I'm just running the trip service. And this is the magic, right? The trip service is running locally on 8080. We have this thing tunnel, and this is actually something that Restate Cloud knows how to route to. So if I do dep register on that, then it kind of finds the trip service, even though it's running on my laptop. Yeah. It finds it,
right.
Which is really helpful, and that just works. And now when I do this, it's actually calling my local service, but then the trips service is calling, you know, all the other ones, right? Trips is calling cars, flights, whatever, and they're all still running in Lambda. But the nice thing is that the calling code doesn't need to know where they run at all. And, you know, Restate, because it's this orchestrator, is figuring out, you know, keeping track of where everything runs and how to route things to the right places. So it can route to my laptop, it can route to Lambda, it can route to Kubernetes, Fargate, and these things are all completely zero code change, which is really nice.
Okay. Can we, in that case, just put a quick breakpoint on the trip
we can,
service so
yeah,
we can see that
we can.
Running locally and...
Yeah, we definitely can. So this is trips HTTP2. That's it here. I have a bunch of breakpoints set for some reason. Let's just disable all of them. Oh, you know what? Screw it. Let's just add them back.
That's pretty wrong because we just want to see a trigger. We don't really mind the where.
Yeah. Let's do this one then. Okay. Let's go. So that should be fine. And then if we get back to Z. Bingo. So this
Okay,
is really
so this
nice.
is, yeah,
Yeah, go ahead.
so that means that I can actually be working on a change for the trips part, but all the other services can stay, as they are, and I can do
Exactly.
the breakpoints, I can iterate, I can change things without having to, I guess having everything running locally. This might be quite useful, especially for I guess for environments where maybe it's a little bit harder for you to deploy everything quickly and whatnot.
Exactly. I mean, otherwise, I think you would need to use like the local step functions interpreter, or I mean, I'm not even sure how you would approach this otherwise. But yeah, I mean, obviously, this is useful development. It's also useful just if, for example, you want to, take something off of Lambda and maybe move it onto Fargate for performance reasons or cost reasons. And yeah, you can just do that transparently, and it will just affect new invocations. So existing invocations generally will keep running where they are, but new invocations can just start using the new one. And yeah, this is cool.
Gotcha.
The other
Yeah,
thing
that's
we've been
really
talking
nice.
about is maybe the ability to even take a running invocation and say, take this to my machine. If it's failing, maybe you want to debug it. You could be like, actually, I want to inspect that. So this is something that we're thinking about doing pretty soon as well.
Okay. Yeah, that'd be really nice. But in that case, how would you do that? Would you, I guess, say once you failed, you can have some way to replay from failure, and then at that point, you say, okay, when you do the replay, hit the local version instead of the remote version.
Yeah, so there's a couple of different things. One of them would be indeed just storing the journal of a failed invocation and being like, let's run that again, but on my laptop. Maybe I should stop sharing now. Not that I have any idea how to do that.
Okay.
There we go.
You go.
So you can move like a completed but failed invocation down locally. And then the other option is that if you have something that's stuck failing because it's not throwing like a terminal error, it's throwing like a temporary error that Restate will keep retrying, then maybe you could tell Restate, this invocation, take it to my machine and then run it locally. And obviously your local code needs to have the same it needs to have AWS creds that can do the same things, for example. But generally, when developing, you would have those sorts of things. This is cool.
Okay, that's looks good. But yeah, this looks really nice. I guess I understand why there's so much excitement around what you guys are doing. If someone wants to try it out today, where do they go and what's the best place to get started if they want to try restating sort of more serverless context?
Yeah, I think go to restate.dev, go to the docs, there's a quick start. I would just start locally. That's absolutely like a really good way to get going with Restate to start running your first services. And then once you want to deploy, in our examples repo, there is like a full TypeScript CDK example that you can use. And you can use that against cloud, or you can use it against like a EC2. I imagine your users will want to use it against cloud. And similarly in the docs, there's a lot of docs about cloud and getting started with that as well. So I think everything you need should be in the docs. Just get going with a quick start, play around with the local dev experience, and the cloud, the serverless dev experience should be exactly the same as the local dev experience. So it's always good to get going locally, I would say.
So I'm on the examples repo. Where do I go for the CDK example that I can follow along?
Let me check. I think the CDK one is in. Yeah, templates slash TypeScript Lambda CDK. And this is also one that you can just by running the Restate CLI, you can run Restate example, and then you can pick this and it will create the folder locally and you can get going from there.
Okay, great. I think that's probably the one that's most interesting for me right now. I'll include those links in the show notes so that anyone else who's looking at this can have easier time to find it as well. So, Restate.dev for the homepage to get the quick start guide, as well as the CDK TypeScript Lambda example. Okay.
Great.
All right, Jack, thank you so much for doing this again. And again, I apologize for Riverside's failure. yeah, this looks really interesting, really cool. I think it does address a lot of the problems that people have with step functions. Wish you guys the best of luck and hope to catch you maybe at reInvent.
Yeah. Thank you for coming in this year for sure. That'd be awesome.
Sounds good. Cool.
All right. Great.
Take easy, guys. And thanks for for joining us again, Jack. And see you soon. Okay. Bye-bye.
Great. Bye-bye.
Thank you to Momento for supporting this episode. To learn more about the real-time data platform and how they can help you accelerate product development, go to gomomento.co/theburningmonk for more information.